Polycystic kidney disease is a genetic disorder causing the growth of multiple cysts that can impair renal function. Its clinical manifestations can easily be remembered with the ethical mnemonic, which tells you that it can present with worsening eGFR, tender flanks, and hypertension, while its main complications include intracranial aneurysms, cardiac disease, abdominal hernias, and liver cysts. I also want you to remember the rough rule of 350s. It has a mean onset of symptoms at 50 years old, 50% of patients get end-stage kidney disease, yet only 50% of people actually find out they have it. Based on its pathogenesis, it can be classified into two types, autosomal recessive PKD and autosomal dominant PKD. The recessive disease is rarer and mostly affects the pediatric population. Autosomal dominant PKD is more common, typically has an adult onset, and is the main focus of this video. Now, the dominant version is caused by a mutation in PKD1 or the PKD2 gene. 80% of people have PKD1 mutations, and conveniently 2 goes with 2, so 20% have PKD2. These genes code for polycystin 1 or 2, which are membrane proteins found in nearly all renal tubular cells, specifically on their cilium, which are like the hair-like projections from cells. These proteins function as mechanoreceptors, which help to inhibit cellular proliferation. When they're dysfunctional, you get uncontrolled cell turnover and fluid buildup, causing cysts. As they grow, the surrounding normal tissue is damaged and progressively compressed. Before we move on to clinical features, if you're a student, don't forget to subscribe and check out the description for my underutilized must-haves for clinical placements. Let's break down my ethical mnemonic to understand the renal and extrarenal features of PKD. E stands for eGFR. Over time, renal function declines. The onset and extent of this failure actually has massive variability between families and even within families. However, males usually have a more rapid progression in general. T stands for tender flanks, and pain comes from three major causes. Firstly, kidney stones, which is more common in PKD. Infection, either from pyelonephritis or from an infected cyst. Finally, rupturing cysts, which can cause massive hematuria. H is for hypertension. In general, cardiovascular dysfunction is the major cause of mortality in PKD. Hypertension occurs before any reduction in GFR and is probably caused by an increased activation of the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. Now, the rest of the mnemonic works really well because you'll remember the extrarenal complications from least to most common. I stands for intracranial aneurysms. These are present in 10% of patients and occur because dysfunctional polycystin also causes defects in arterial smooth muscles. C is for cardiac disease. This occurs in 20% of patients, which you can remember by doubling 10%. Valvular disease is often how this manifests, especially mitral valve prolapse. A stands for abdominal wall hernias. This occurs in 40% of patients, which you can also remember by doubling 20%. This mostly manifests as inguinal and paraumbilical hernias. Finally, L stands for liver cysts. Polycystic liver disease eventually occurs in 80% of patients, which you can remember by obviously doubling 40. These are more common in women because estrogen receptors are expressed in the epithelial lining of the cysts. Moving on to investigations, I just want to make this really clear and succinct. A positive family history with signs and symptoms is highly suggestive of PKD. Now, definitive diagnosis can be made via imaging, usually with a kidney ultrasound, screening for multiple cysts. It's important to know that genetic testing is actually only required if there is diagnostic uncertainty or to assist with future family planning. We can manage PKD through lifestyle optimization, strict blood pressure control, specific disease-modifying drugs, and complication management. Healthy lifestyle choices are vital and include smoking cessation, weight optimization, and regular exercise. Good blood pressure control actually reduces the progression of renal disease and risk of cardiovascular complications. In patients with early stage disease, the recommended target is about 120 on 70, although these guidelines vary based on your country and disease stage. Either ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers are the first-line drug classes to consider in PKD-induced hypertension. Now, disease-modifying agents are relatively new treatment options. As ADH augments kidney cyst growth, Tolvaptan, which is an ADH antagonist, is indicated in patients with a high risk of developing kidney failure. Complications should be investigated and treated appropriately. Chronic flank pain is often overlooked by healthcare providers, so you should always ask a patient if they have this. Watch out for intracranial aneurysms, but remember, small ones less than 7 millimeters are usually just managed conservatively. Finally, a renal transplant is the main treatment of choice for end-stage kidney disease. To remember our management, use this mnemonic to increase a patient's lifespan. Make them a sportsman, give them a sartan for their blood pressure, then Tolvaptan, and consider renal transplant. Don't forget that PKD is the ethical disease presenting with worsening eGFR, tender flanks, and hypertension. Its main complications include intracranial aneurysms, cardiac disease, abdominal hernias, and liver cysts. If you love mnemonics, you should really check out this playlist for more ways to remember high-yield content. Thanks for watching Townsend Teaching.